Podcast. This is episode 13. Today is Sunday, May 15th, and I'm your host, Jacqueline Salem. If this is your first time checking out the podcast, thank you so much for taking a look-see at all the things I make. And if you're a returning viewer, thank you so much for coming back. You can find me on social media as at Jacqueline Salem, pretty much anywhere, Pinterest, Twitter, although I don't really use it that much. Instagram is where I'm like the most findable and post a lot and interact with people. So if you want to find me there, you can. This is a podcast that focuses mostly on knitting and sometimes other just random crafts and sewing things that I get up to. I live in Brooklyn, New York City with a roommate and my two cats, and this is my life. Show notes for the podcast can be found on the Ravelry group, which you can find in the groups tab by searching Brooklyn Knit Folk Podcast. And with that, I think that's all the introductions, so let's go for it. Today has been really quite gray outside. It's been super, super rainy lately. It is spring, so I guess it is to be, you know, expected, I guess. But I'm ready for the warmer weather, but also trying not to rush it. So I currently have a friend visiting me in town right now, and I love having her here, and I love it when people come visit me, so that's been really fun. And my mom and sister are going to be coming 2 weeks from now, so I cannot wait for them to come here together and us to have a good time. Planning on going to like Coney Island and lots of other fun stuff. So can't wait for that. So let's start with finished objects. The first one is one I'm wearing, which is this dress. If you are new to the podcast, a few episodes ago I showed a technique that I like to use to make garments, and that's by not really making them. I bought this at a thrift store forever ago, and it was like super long. Let me see if I can move this camera a little bit. I might try to insert a picture here, by the way, if I can't show you this effectively, but this dress was super long, came like way down here, and so I decided to shorten it and hem it into something I would actually wear. So that's what this is. So yeah, I'm not sure if I can exactly call that a finished object, but I am, because I just hemmed it and now it's something I will wear as opposed to something I wouldn't have before. I do that a lot with thrift store finds. I just buy like skirts that are way too long and then hem them or take them in if they're too big or alter them to fit my body in some way. So this is exactly what I mean by that. So I showed you this before, now you know what it looks like. The underside, this might get a little awkward, sorry, is not the prettiest. Like, I just cut it. I could have turned it again to make a better hem, but I kind of cut it a little bit too short for my taste. So I didn't want to use more of it to hem the underside just so that the backside would look pretty. So I just kind of left it as it was. So I think I'll probably end up wearing this mostly like how I'm wearing it now, with tights, and maybe a few times in the summer bare legs, but like I said, it's a little bit too short for what I am comfortable wearing. So yeah, that's my first finished object. Stand up on the couch again so you can see. Check out these really great slippers, you guys. Some realness for you there. So yeah, overall jumper, dress, love it. Next finished object, again, some small finished objects, but I am participating in the Mandarines, the Be Mandarines podcast. If you haven't watched it, it's a really, really good one. She is hosting a seasonal and local swap where you find things that are seasonal and local to your area and then send them to your swap partner. I technically have two partners because somebody signed up late and I was like, well, I don't mind having two. That sounds great. So that's what I did. And as part of my, so this is kind of a spoiler, but don't worry if you watch, I'm not sure if they even watch the podcast or not, my podcast that is, so maybe they won't even see this, but I made these little lavender sachets I bought at the farmer's market. Bunch of these little lavender packages with local New York lavender, I guess. And took extra fabric that I had from my 2-inch squares quilt, which I show on episodes 2 and 3. So if you're interested in seeing what that looks like, you can see it there. But basically it's made out of 2-inch square fabric. I'm not doing a very good job showing this, but you get the idea. 2-inch squares. The 2-inch squares by themselves are not big enough to make these lavender sachets. So I thought if I stitched 4 of them together on each side, that that would be the perfect size. And that's what I did. So you can see how tiny these things, I mean, these are probably 2 inches by 2 inches once all is said and done because of the seam allowances for stitching these together. But I made a few of these to put into my seasonal and local swap because I thought that would be special. They smell so good. I want to make some more of these for myself. I don't know, this might be like my signature thing that I put in future swap packages or something. Because yeah, that quilt is really special to me. If you haven't seen those previous episodes, it's just like, it was a 5-year project in the making and it's on my bed now and I love it and it took forever, but it was worth it. So it just kind of feels like an heirloom quality piece. So these are kind of special and reflective of that. So yeah, so those are my 2 finished objects, the sachets, if you call them finished objects, and my overall jumper. So next we're gonna go into works in progress. Like everybody else in the knitting community, it seems, I have been obsessed with my Cozy Memories blanket, like obsessed. And so far you've only seen them in their square-like form, but I finally put them together. So it's starting to look like a blanket now, which is really exciting. The last one I showed you, let's see, they're not in order of the time I've made them, so you've already seen a few of these, but the 2 new ones are this one right here, which I've been focusing on a mostly neutrals palette lately. I'm going to try to do at least every other square is neutral, but probably the whole thing in as much neutral as possible, with pops here and there of squares that have brighter yarns in them. So that was the first one that I made that you haven't seen already. And then this one, see if I can fold this up in a way that makes it easier to see. The second one is this one, which I created this palette completely around this mini of Druzy Rising yarn right here, and then picked out colors that would go with that. So I love how this square turned out so far. I think this is maybe my favorite square that I've made so far, but I also really, really love this one that I made back in February. So we're together. So yeah, obsessed with making it. It's just so mindless to make it, but so it's very like comfort knitting. I can do it while I watch TV, and I've recently started Game of Thrones, so I'll talk about later. So I need something that is simple so I can pay attention to that. So yeah. It's blanket-like now. I'm really excited about how this looks. I love every, there's not a Cozy Memories blanket that I've seen that I have not liked, but I just kind of wanted to do something a little bit different, and I'm super excited about how this is looking. I just love how I can kind of create these color stories around the different yarns together and kind of, or group them by, you know, who gifted them to me or, you know, whatever I'm feeling like at the time. So thank you all, by the way, for people who have responded to my call for neutrals minis. If you haven't heard, I am looking for lots of neutral mini skeins, so if you have them and don't need them and want to send them to me, I'm happy to take them off your hands. So, Cozy Memories blanket, obsessed because of Shannon of the Sock Cetra podcast, who is hosting the Blanket Blitzcal. I'm not sure when that ends, but I think it's at the end of May, maybe, but I'll probably just be blanket blitzing all summer because it's such a lightweight thing for me to do. It's not like I have to hold my entire blanket while I'm making it, so I can just work on one square and then I mattress stitch them together. The seam is pretty, honestly, pretty unnoticeable to me anyway. Let me see if I can, yeah, show you. See? Pretty much undetectable. And that's the back side. So yeah, the back side's where you can kind of see it more, I guess. But in the front, to me, it's pretty difficult to tell. So yay, cozy memories blanket. Obsessed with it. Next work in progress is part of my Summer Lovin' make-along. So Katrina of the Yarn 30 podcast and myself are hosting the Summer Lovin' make-along. Summer Lovin' with no G on the end of loving, M-A-L. You can make anything summer-related. Last podcast I accidentally said knit-along, but it's not. You can just, whatever you want, whatever craft you want to do. Knitting, crochet, sewing. It doesn't even have to be like a fiber craft, so whatever you want to do is okay by us. It started on May 1st and goes until June 20th because that's the first official day of summer, so we thought that that was appropriate for a Summer Lovin' make-along. And I am making the Beach Tank by Jess Scriebstein. She's the Kitchen Witch on Instagram. Her Instagram feed is really, really pretty. Its home is in my Diary of a Yarn Snob project bag, which I ordered from Jewels. I am obsessed with this bag. It's new. I love the grid fabric, but one of my favorite things about it, sorry, yarn flying, so no sushi. Love the grid fabric, but it has this pebble fabric interior. And for anybody who has, who's an OG Mac user, will know that that pebble fabric was the default image on the, I think, what year did I get that laptop? I got it in 2007, but I'm sure they probably, I don't know if they used it before that, but in my 2007 laptop, the default image for the background was this, almost looks exactly the same as this pebble fabric that's on the inside of this. So that just made me laugh to myself. That's why I got it. So this bag is really beautiful, really well made, has pockets that I use. This is huge too. This could definitely fit a sweater project, for sure. And here is the project, the process on the beach tank. Progress. It's supposed to be knit in pieces, but I'm knitting it in the round so that I don't have to do any purling on it, so I'm just like straight knitting. And I'm holding it double, which is what the pattern calls for, with this black 50-50 linen and cotton blend, and then also Knit Picks gloss, which I just ran out of this skein, so I'm gonna have to go get another one. You've seen, oh, one second, let me get it. And then the other half is this Knit Picks gloss DK, which is 70% merino and 30% silk, which gives it this lovely sheen to it. I'm knitting this size small. The pattern calls to be knit on size 9 needles, but I dropped down to an 8 because I wasn't getting gauge when I did kind of like an initial swatch in the beginning, but it's still looking a little bit too big. I'm okay if it's looser. I've tried it on and it's a little bit too loose for what I was looking for, but it's not the end of the world. It's not like drastically too large, but I'm loving the marled effect that the yarn is having and how kind of inconsistent it is from holding it double. This is my first time using a project that holds any yarns double together, so that's been kind of fun to see how that works. The stretch is really nice, and cotton, knitting with cotton and linen, kind of non-animal fiber yarns. In the past, I've made some dishcloths. It completely killed my hands. It was like really hard to knit with it because the yarn is not stretchy like wool yarns are, but this is really great because it's using one yarn that is the cotton linen and the other yarn is a wool yarn, and so it still has that stretchiness to it, so it's not as difficult as if I was just knitting with straight cotton. So this is a great pattern for that reason. But yeah, I'm totally loving how it looks. It's flying by. It's a cropped tank top, And so I'm definitely more than 50% finished with this, but yeah, won't be long. It has an I-cord straps on it that I'll attach to it. So yeah. And again, this is the Beach Tank pattern by Jess Griebstein, knitting it on size 8 needles. And I think that's all I really wanted to say about it. But yeah, join the Summer 11 make along if you haven't already. We are open to any ideas that will make your project fit into a Summer 11 theme. So it could be really bright yarn, it could be a cotton or linen project, it could be a bag for the farmer's market that you're making. You know, we're really open to whatever you want to do with it. And double dipping in other cows is totally fine with us. So yay, I'm loving it. It's just so nice, it's so squishy. I will say though, that because it's knit on such large needles, the stitches are giant. It's almost like, it does feel really thick and heavy, and even though it's cotton, I'm not altogether convinced that it's not gonna be too hot to wear, but I guess I'll find out. I wear tank tops all year round anyway, so I can just, cause I layer clothing, so. It wouldn't be that big of a deal if I could only wear it in the winter, but we'll see. When it gets to more tank top status, I can try it on and kind of see how I feel. Maybe I'll end up adding sleeves to it. We'll see. So yeah, Beach Tank Cal, or Beach Tank Cal, well, she is hosting a Beach Tank Cal, but this is the Beach Tank Tank for the Summer Lovin' Make Along. All right. Next project is my Hetty shawl. I had started this at the Washington County Farm and Fiber Tour, and I've since made quite a bit of progress on this. It's knit, the entire border is knit first. And then after you knit the whole border, you pick up the stitches along the interior and knit, I think it's either garter or stockinette, to fill up kind of the triangle. And so I'm over 50% of the way finished with chart A. I'm making it considerably larger. It calls to knit chart A 31 times, but I'm gonna add 10 extra repeats of the chart, of each of them to make it a lot bigger because I prefer bigger shawls myself. And I'm just loving how this Brooklyn tweed is knitting up with this cables. The sample that she knitted in used Madeline Tosh, which looked lovely, but to me it just really felt like it should be a woolier yarn, which is what I'm using. So this is Brooklyn tweed Shelter, which is their worsted weight, in Hayloft. Love this color. And I'm, yeah, again, I think it looks so cool. Last night I was knitting on this and I was looking at the cables and I just thought to myself, I'm so surprised I haven't made a mistake yet. And then I looked up and like maybe an hour later and noticed that I had made a mistake with the cable. And I had completely forgotten to even put a cable in here at all. So it was just kind of straight knitting right there from having all these lovely cables before. And I knew it was probably a simple process to drop down to fix it rather than tinking back 8 rows, which was what would have been necessary to fix this mistake. So I tried to look up some tutorials and some videos how to do it. And there was one from Barocco that looked pretty simple. So I tried it and it's definitely not 100% right, but this was straight all the way through here. So I did managed to drop down and fix the cable part, but somehow I've turned this part into a giant cable. Whatever, it doesn't look as bad as if it was just straight knitting and from far away it's not the end of the world. So, and it's not even going to be close to where the center of the shawl is, so I'm not that concerned about it anymore compared to how it looked when it was just straight. That looked weird to me, so I'm okay with this. And plus I just take it as like a learning experience from trying to drop down to fix things. I'll definitely try that again in the future. It wasn't that it was difficult, but I think I was just, the dropping down part wasn't hard, but when I was kind of knitting it back up was a little bit confusing, but yeah. It's all the realness here. All the realness. all the mistakes. So this is where I was the last time I showed you, and I have since doubled where I was before with chart A. Chart C will have kind of like a diamond in the middle of it, and then chart, chart B will have like a diamond in the middle of it, and then chart C will basically mimic this side but opposite, and then I'll be picking up stitches. So I think out of the 41 repeats I'm going to be doing on this, I think I have like, I don't know, maybe 10 to 15 left to go in this first chart. Yeah, I'm just really liking it. This is my first experience using Brooklyn tweed yarn, and I know it can be quite polarizing about what people think of it, because since it's woolen spun, it tends to break pretty easily, but my gauge has significantly loosened up and I'm not so much a tight knitter anymore. I wouldn't say I'm really loose either. It depends, maybe on Magic Loop I get pretty loose, but I've not had any problems whatsoever with yarn breakage or even feeling like it was going to come close to doing that. So if that's put you on the fence about trying Brooklyn tweed, I would say that if you're a semi-regular to loose knitter, that you would be totally fine. I can't really say for tight knitting, because I don't really know for sure, but I'm really liking it so far, and I just love the texture that this yarn has and is creating. It's not like it's the super softest I've ever had, but it's also, I've heard it also changes a lot with blocking, and it doesn't feel uncomfortable to wear by any means. So I just really love how it's turning out, and how especially Brooklyn tweed and cables, you just cannot go wrong with that. It is gorgeous, if I do say so myself. So yeah, so that's the Hetty shawl by Isolde Teague. I'm knitting it on size 7 needles. I feel like once I get one size 7 needles project off the needles, then I'm using it again. I feel like size 7 is probably one of the most common needle sizes that I use for my projects for whatever reason. They're never just sitting in my stash. 7s and 5s. That's the Hetty shawl by Isolde Teague. The next project is my Exploration Station, which I have not made even one single stitch of progress on this. To be honest, I probably have too many projects going right now for what I'm comfortable with. It's not that I'm a monogamous knitter, but I don't usually have this many going. But I figure I'll just show you again really quickly, just so you can kind of see what the colors look like together. I know that people have been telling me every time they see this that they love this color combination, and that it's almost convinced them to knit an Exploration Station when they might not have before. So I thought I'd just pop this in really quick to inspire you. If you're curious about what all these yarns are, you can check out my project page or previous episodes. I've gone over this in great detail in previous episodes, but I'm just right before the brioche section. So I need to look up some tutorials and do some practice before I start doing that. But so far, this is what it's looking like. It's mostly woolen vine yarns, some hedgehog fibers, and skeiny dipping. I've also made a little bit of progress on my Fine and Dandy socks, but not enough that would be worth it to show you. I think the next time I show you, I'll only show when I have a finished sock. So those are all of my works in progress. I guess we'll move on into some stash enhancements / acquisitions. So as I mentioned, my amazing friend Tracy is visiting from Nashville right now. And Nashville has maybe I'm biased because I'm from there, but I think it has a pretty thriving craft culture. And they have an amazing store called Craft South, which you may or may not have heard of. Wolfel podcast a while ago. Anna Maria Horner, she owns the Craft South shop in Nashville, Tennessee. And they stocked, at least to previously, had been stocking Camilla Fiber Company. They've previously stocked Camilla Fiber Company. Apparently they're not anymore. This is what I got the last time I was there. This is their CFC Camilla Fiber Company plume base, and the colorway is called Birthday Cake. It's 40% alpaca, 40% merino, and 20% silk. It's so lovely and so nice, but I bought this before I realized that I was allergic to alpaca. So I'm not sure, the alpaca I've only used before that I know I'm itchy from is not good quality yarn at all, but it's So I'm not really sure if I bought like a better quality alpaca, if that would change. So I'm not sure if I'm gonna knit this for myself and chance it, or maybe just knit this as a gift item. Either way, I really love this color, so I haven't quite decided what I'm going to do with it yet. But Camilla Fiber Company, she makes absolutely gorgeous yarn. And I asked Tracy, my friend asked me if there's anything she wanted me to bring, have her bring for me. And I was like, oh, can you go to the store and get some Camilla Fiber Company? And she was like, what color? And I was like, I don't care, just pick something. But the truth be told, like every single skein that Camilla Fiber Company has, I've liked. There's not even one single color that I don't like from them. I just love her color palettes. This is kind of atypical from most of the ones she has. Most of them are like neutrals, like sand colors, light blues, whites, white and black, marled. So I knew there was not one single thing that she could have gotten that I would not have liked anyway. But she came back with this. This is the Targi Super Bulky Hand Spun, 100% American Targi wool, and there's 70 yards in this. To be honest, I have never worked with super bulky yarn before, so I have absolutely no clue what I'm gonna do with this, but it is so squishy, so nice. It is, yeah, super soft. So if you have used super bulky yarn before and have suggestions about what I might do with this, please let me know. I'm sure, I've looked on Ravelry for people who have owned this, and so far I've seen like one hat and I think like something they were using in blanket maybe, but I only have the one skein and I'm not gonna buy like a million of these to make a blanket. So if you have a suggestion, maybe a cowl, like a small cowl, if I combine it with something else. There's this brioche cowl by Olga Baraya Kefalian. I'm blanking on the name right now. I'll insert a picture of it here so you can see what it looks like. I love that cowl. I doubt it's made in super bulky yarn, but maybe I could figure out a way to adapt the pattern. Here I go again, trying to substitute yarn weights. I really should have learned my lesson the first few times that I've tried that and it didn't work out, but you know, gotta go for it. So yeah, Camilla Fiber Company. She got this at Craft South. I love this. I'm just not exactly sure what I'm going to do with it yet, but it's really, really beautiful and hand spun. So that's awesome. The second thing she got for me is this skein of Over Under Repeat. It's another Nashville local skein. It's 100% silk noil. And I haven't looked up what the difference is between silk and like regular silk and silk noil. Devin, who is half of the Tiny Paper Foxes podcast, was sort of explaining it to me yesterday, but I need to do some more research and figure out what it is. But I'm in love with this color. It says it's a 2-ply sport weight, and how many yards? 400 yards, and it's a 2-ply sport weight, but this, to me, does not look like sport weight. I don't know. I'm sure I could use that, not in socks, not that I would use silk noil in socks anyway, but I'm sure I could get away with using this in any kind of fingering weight substitution. But yeah, this color is called Copper. It's got this lovely sheen to it. It feels extremely sturdy. It's not very stretchy, not at all stretchy. So yeah, I just love that color. I'm not sure if that's coming up right with the window being right there, but see if I can turn off this overhead light. Yeah, that's a little bit better. So yeah, Over Under Repeat, Nashville local yarn. So yeah, I'm in love with this color too. I don't know what it's gonna be yet, but it's awesome. The next acquisitions. Yesterday at the New York Knit Nerds, which is kind of a knitting group that we've started here in New York City, we had a goodbye party for Jenny and Devin of the Tiny Paper Foxes podcast because they're moving to Vermont. Sad face. But after we were at the park, we went to Argyle Yarn Shop. And Argyle is well known because they have, they're the Quinson Company seller in New York City, the only one. And every time I go there, I find Madeline Tosh Optic, which is a specific colorway that I look for in every store that sells Madeline Tosh, but I never find it except for at this yarn store. This is a hat that I knit out of Optic a long time ago. This is the Facets hat by Rose Beck. And this is the Singles Worsted. in the Optic colorway. And as you can see, it's like this creamy, you know, color with speckles of black and navy. And then hints, it's kind of hard to see it in this particular skein that I use for this hat, but it does have hints of like a brownish, reddish color in it. So I saw, they had worsted weight also, but I tend to knit mostly with fingering weight yarns. So I saw these and I had to have them. It's Tosh Merino Light. It's a singles base yarn. Incredibly soft in the Optic colorway. So I picked the two that I thought looked the most similar out of all the ones they have. I don't know what this is gonna be yet. Probably a shawl that I can use it just on its own. Maybe combine it with one other color, but I just really want something that makes this colorway shine because it is my favorite colorway that I've ever seen to date. I'm obsessed with it. So yeah, that's, again, Madeline Tosh in Optic. Oh, I have this on here and I meant to show you really quick. The Hedy shawl I showed you guys earlier. This is gonna be the color I use when I pick up the stitches. This is Barn Owl. Sorry, I had this in front of me and I just forgot to mention that. But yeah, so Optic. So as I mentioned, I'm participating in the Bee Mandarines seasonal and local swap. And I went to the farmer's market to pick out some goodies, and while I was there, I could not resist getting something for myself. This is the Catskills Merino Farm. So here's the tag. Catskills Merino, a small farm with a flock of sheep. And this is their Saxon Merino wool. It's 100%, it's like local, or 100% Merino wool, and local to New York State, New York City, in the Catskills, which is probably, I don't know, an hour or two outside of New York City, if that. So this is the skein that I got. I've already balled it up because I've used some of it. I decided to hand wind it because it was so tangly. I will say I cannot stand the way that they had it laid out for people to see at the farmer's market because it wasn't skeined up like this. It was kind of just like hanging in the loops, and it was extremely tangly and finicky to even attempt to try to, you know, I put it on my Swift and it was just not having it. So I had to like literally stand there by hand and untangle it bit by bit. So this was a labor of love, but I am in love with this color called February Green. I got this specifically to use in my Cozy Memories blanket because this is, chartreuse is my favorite color. And so many minis that I have and color palettes that I really love, I think that this color would look really great. And I got one mini from somebody, I'm not sure who it was, and I've since used up every bit of that chartreuse color. So I decided to get a skein of a chartreuse color so that I could use it specifically in my Cozy Memories blanket. And it says that it's a fingering weight yarn, but this is more, a little bit heavier to me, more like sport or DK. Not quite worsted. But yeah, I love this. So I won't show what I got for my swap partners in case I do watch this podcast because I don't want to ruin the surprise, but this is what I got for myself. And I think that's all of my acquisitions and things I've bought recently. So now I'm gonna move on to the final segment for today, which is things that I am loving. And the first one, you guys really loved the makeup recommendations that I gave you in episodes forever ago, and I still will go on and on about that mascara because it's amazing. Lancôme, Grandiose, any Lancôme mascara, honestly, but specifically Grandiose and the Hypnos Lancôme mascaras. Amazing. I've had several people actually text me or send me messages on Instagram while they're out shopping asking what that was so that they could get it while they were out. So that was pretty fun. But my next makeup recommendation is kind of a one that was surprising to me. I was given a $100 gift card to Sephora because of a project I was working on at work that was related to makeup, which was really fun. And I've been seeing these Clinique Cheek Pop blushes for forever on beauty blogs. That's how I got into YouTube in the first place, actually, was by watching beauty blogs. And I was trying to pick out a color for myself. So I had the ladies at Sephora help me pick out a color, and she came over and she's like, actually, this Nude Pop shade is really, really great. And Nude Pop is honestly the one of the last ones I would have ever chosen because, I don't know if you can really tell on camera, but I'm not like super, super like light skin. So I'm pretty fairly tan. So I hardly ever go for things that are like the nude shade of anything because it's hard to see. But she tested this on me. It's gonna be kind of hard to see the awesome packaging because I've been using it so much, but it's this little cute flower mold. But she tested it on me, and this nude pop shade is amazing. I love it. I use it every day. I wouldn't call this like a nighttime blush. I'm wearing it right now, but it just gives your cheeks a really natural, pretty flush, and I'm obsessed with it. So that's the Clinique Cheek Pop in Nude Pop. Obsessed with this lately. The next thing I want to talk about, because who doesn't love drinking, is Vino Verde wines. This has been a favorite of mine for years. When I was first introduced to it, I fell in love immediately. Vino Verde wines, I'll show you this tag here. This is not the only one, by the way, and it's, I wouldn't even call this one my favorite. It's just what, I just try different ones when I see them. Vino Verde wines, I have the benefit of being pretty inexpensive, actually. They're usually like anywhere between like $8 and $20 tops, but usually somewhere in like the $10 to $15 range. I don't really like sweet wine at all, or sweet alcohol in general, so this has kind of got a drier taste, but an effervescent sort of finish to it, so it's sort of bubbly, not as much as a champagne or a Prosecco would be, but a little bit more than just kind of like a flat white wine. I'm obsessed with Vino Verde wines. They're really perfect for summer. So if you're in your wine shop and looking for something new to try and you like white wines, I would definitely give a Vino Verde a try. If you like Sauvignon Blancs or something that's a little bit drier than like a Riesling, this is definitely one that you should add to your list of wines to try. Not this one again in particular. My personal favorite is a brand called Casal Garcia. I'll put all of this in the show notes. But for some reason, I can't ever find that in New York City, so I'm not sure if it's only local to the South, which is where I'm from and where I would get it all the time. But yeah, Vino Verde wines. The wine grapes are grown in Portugal mostly. I'm not a wine snob or even a wine connoisseur at all, like the last person who would be, but I really love Vino Verde wines. So, Allie and Abby, that recommendation is for you. And then the next thing, I almost feel a little bit awkward talking about this because it's like, I don't know, whatever, I shouldn't be. But I've recently started a new workout program called BBG, which stands for, get ready for it, it's a stupid name, Bikini Body Guide. I know, it's like really, really dumb name, but the workouts are insanely good. One of my friends gave it to me, the ebook. It's like a downloadable PDF for me to try, and I've been doing them, and I look at them and I'm like, oh, that'll be a piece of cake. And then 30 minutes later, because the workouts are 28 minutes long, I'm pretty much peeling myself off the floor because they're so difficult and so sweaty. So if you're looking for a really great workout program to try, I highly, highly recommend this one. I will say that like Instagram plays a huge role in it, so even just like browsing the BBG hashtags, like BBG or BBG progress, the whole community is incredibly inspiring and uplifting and nice to one another, which I find is not really the case, especially with workout programs that you're posting on social media. I've found you get a lot of backlash and, I don't know, just really inappropriate and rude, mean comments, but this community is very supportive with one another. So if you're looking for something that you kind of like do on your own, but you want to post about it and have like a community with it, but you don't necessarily want to suffer and look stupid doing it in front of other people, I think this would be a really good one to try because I'm really liking it so far. So I thought I would pass that along. And Game of Thrones. That's my last one. I know, I'm like super late to this party. I didn't even watch Breaking Bad until it was in its last season, but I am really loving Game of Thrones. I just started it and finished the first season, so basically I've resigned myself to having no life and plenty of knitting time, I guess, for the next like month or two while I binge watch this show. It's really good. It's very violent, for sure. Lots of boobies, but it's, if that stuff doesn't bother you, then you should definitely give it a watch if you haven't already. I'm probably the last person on Earth. Well, my friend Tracy, who's here, hasn't watched it, so I'm not the last person on Earth, but I'm one of the last people on Earth to watch this show. So if you are by chance and you have HBO and you haven't seen it, maybe give it a go, because it's pretty good. So this is probably going to be an abrupt ending, but I don't really have anything else for you. So with that, I will say goodbye, and I'll see you in the next video. Oh, speaking of next video, I've just made another Brooklyn Knit Folk in the Wild video about my favorite, one of my favorite restaurants, but my absolute favorite Mexican restaurant in New York City called El Presidente Tacomi. The tacos are incredible. It's amazing. So I'm about to upload another Brooklyn Knit Folk in the Wild video. Thank you so much for your support and for telling me how much you like these videos. This is why I do this. So I will see you in the next one. Bye. Okay, I'm back. One more thing that I forgot to tell you about. It's this app called Fuse, F-Y-U-S-E. Trust me, download it. My friend Tracy and I have been using that thing nonstop since she told me about it. It is so awesome. And it's free. It's an app where it takes it's a camera picture GIF app, and you swipe it across yourself or an object or something like that, and it takes a lot of pictures and makes like a 3D photograph. So like when you move your phone, it kind of moves around the object that you had just taken a picture of. I'll insert a picture of it here, and you probably saw some in the clips in the beginning. But yeah, go check it out and download this app. It is so cool. It's called Fuse, F-Y-U-S-E. Trust me. Okay, bye.